Hello. On today's episode 5 of Society Blends, I thought about a subject that is quite interesting in its own right, although we probably take it for granted. I thought about the internet's influence on children and teen development, and I thought specifically about challenges that appear due to a couple of reasons for the moment. And I also thought about some potential solutions to the current problem, addressing mainly the younger audience and as well parents. And I thought about this because I think that living so much and so early in a highly technological society brings a lot of opportunities, and we have clearly noticed this, but it also brings many potential risks. And I would like to talk about some things that may not necessarily have been connected in the same way, or at least I have not seen them done so at a level that I feel is quite balanced. So I thought about some sides of the problem, like anonymity and trust, the vast amount of information you can find and how it challenges many of our concepts, visual impact, peer mass influence, control, and of course self-control, because there are many difficulties. If you don't want to listen to the more theoretical part, you can skip right away to suggestions. And I think it's just as well if you want to see how some methods that might be useful could be applied in real life. And I hope you will find this video interesting. So let's move on. I thought about anonymity because I think it's the most important element that defines our current internet. Even if in the past, in the long time gone past, actually, anonymity was not necessarily an issue because there were very few places where internet was available and the amount of persons that could have access was limited. As the internet grew, just about anyone could have control over their own way in which they portrayed their identity. And I think that this picture conveys very well the meaning, because ultimately we are very far from what we actually are in real life, in our internet's presence. Whether that is good or bad, it's debatable, but I will show you some interesting facts regarding anonymity. First of all, I think this helps tremendously our way of expressing, because it disconnects us from some ways of behaving in society that are overly limiting. It opens up to a huge audience that is almost the whole world, especially if we are fortunate enough to know, or we have been determined enough to learn world language, like English, for instance. But it also brings its own challenges, because we can guess very, with a lot of difficulty, what actually happens. Who is the person that really conveys the meaning, and if it does so in a trustful manner. But I think that the first element is anonymity. We don't know the name of the person we are talking to. We don't know the identity. We don't know the place. And all of these details that are missing create an opportunity to pass a message, but also create a risk, because we don't know how a person specifically fits in one of our specific ways of judging, because ultimately we use some patterns, and if those patterns fit, it's not necessarily ideal, but it has some sort of safety, of comfort that it provides. And all of these are gone. With a person on the internet, everything is simply gone. Of course, there might be a name, there may be some details, but all of these do not necessarily link enough in order to create such a perspective. Let's move on. I mentioned in passing the point of trust, because just about any time when we are communicating, we have to have a common ground in order to exchange information. We have to, in order to communicate ultimately, we have to have trust in each other. First of all, we have to trust the fact that the information is not going to be used against us. There are not things that are going to be used in order to fret us and create other problems. Unfortunately, the issue of anonymity creates also an issue with trust, because whether those two go hand in hand, and it certainly do not go always hand in hand, as our real life experience shows, with or without the internet, I still think it's an important element, because a particular platform, a particular setting creates a set of expectations. And one of these most important expectations is the one of trust, the fact that the other will take us as granted. And this is actually the basis that probably is even more than anonymity and is at the foundation of the internet. Because if we would not behave slightly responsible, because not everyone does, then the issue of anonymity would just cover everything and trust would not be built. But if we want to be at least somewhat responsible in how we behave on the internet, we need to trust each other and to portray a perspective on us that is quite important, to be based on fundamental facts and ones that can be reasonably verified. Of course, this is very difficult on the internet, because the moment you are taking out identity, you have to fulfill it with something else. And in this case, the presence, the constant message that is being broadcast, I think, is the foundation of trust we build on the internet. Unfortunately, this can also work against us, just as with anonymity. When we are so much able, and some of our peers certainly are, unfortunately, when they are overly capable of portraying constantly and successfully a false image upon the others for nefarious purposes. They want to deceive others, they want to steal something, they want to use an information they have about you in order to corner you. And this clearly happens. And I think that one of the bad aspects of the internet is that it's very hard to block entirely a person if they are behaving inappropriately. And I think this is one of the only major situations that I do not quite see an easy way out of. Because the way in which the internet is being built and the amount of freedom it provides is quite difficult to be entirely centered on an identity that would be disclosed. And the moment that identity is clearly forced upon you, the whole construct of freedom on the internet actually is going to be extinct. And I'm pretty sure that since the internet is mainly a place for experimentation, this is not going to have good consequences. The best approach would be if we would be responsible entirely as a society. Unfortunately, we aren't. And the ways of finding out what happens is not as consistent as it should be. But ultimately, it could be done better. But I think that the issue of trust is very important, because many times we can fall on a trap if we trust too much something that seems too good for us. And especially in the case of young persons, this is even more pervasive, because they do not have all these ways of assessing if something seems at least reasonably acceptable or not. Since they learn so much about the world, and of course the issue of internet communication is not being brought as required in the main education they have, either at formal settings such as school or in their family, I think that this issue is not as well catered for as it should be. Of course, the fact that not that many dangers outright are possible means that there is some sort of balance that happens, but I don't think this is good, and I don't think this will be just as well in the future if we are continuing this. But anyway, the issue of trust is important, because we trust something as even more if we understand less about the world. So the young children are even more at risk. And since we have so many places where it's very easy to have an impact, I think this is a major issue. Trust used for nefarious purposes. And I think that we should be considering even more this issue of trust. And the more we are trying to divert our attention to a specific authority rather than policing ourselves certain behaviors, I think that it's even worse as an outcome than if you would be responsible, particularly responsible as persons who know something and that could and should alert others to know better. But again, we have our own issues as a society, and I'm pretty sure those are not going to be passed anytime soon. But anyway, this is another important issue. The visual impact, yes. I thought so because on the internet it's entirely possible to create a totally detached perspective on something that happened. And having a high visual impact is entirely possible due to all technological advances that make possible photography, video creation, all sorts of virtual experiences that improve as time and technology progresses. And I think that the visual impact is the most important one, because ultimately we are highly visual beings. It doesn't matter how much we think we are having very good grasp of fragrances, of the specific feel of something. Ultimately, we guide our entire lives through visual clues. And even if some of us are better or worse in this respect, we still have a great risk towards being deceived by striking visual presentations. And this is even more so when we are considering the relative lack of not necessarily style, but of a certain way of creating highly attractive creations when you are a young person. And when you see others create such well thought stories that are very well put together, you can be attracted to something that is very good and you should pursue, but it's also the risk of being outright in the danger of following a specific suggestion that may lead to very bad consequences. And I think that those two elements go hand in hand, unfortunately, those two sides. And it's part of why the internet is so powerful, but also so risky. And I think that all the talk about censorship is not really the best way to address such issues, because ultimately, when, as mentioned, we defer authority to a specific instance, we are leaving a lot of our freedom. I think we can police ourselves very well, even if we are not given the means to do so, due to many reasons and interests that are conflicting. The interests of companies that work on the internet that want to be highly impactful, and the interest of persons that want to have reasonable experience, and of course the interest of persons that want only to cause mayhem. And all these free create an environment that is mostly acceptable, but sometimes highly dangerous. And I think that the visual impact is even more present in the current state of things, and will be even more so in the future, due to the fact that the advance in technology could make it possible to make the semblance of reality even better. And this is particularly striking for persons that have not got quite accustomed to how you can deceive reality. Well, actually, how you can deceive the others by faking reality. And this is even more important for younger persons, because, as I said, they don't have the tools and the experience to at least have some sort of defense against this. It's mostly what you feel, mostly your instincts, and instincts are not enough in this case. Let's move. I thought about information abundance, and I think this picture conveys very well the meaning, because ultimately we have so much to enjoy in our lives, so many good aspects, so many good sides, places, environments, ideas that we don't know. And we find them entirely on the internet, because we are mostly connected with a limited community, with a limited amount of places we have visited, understood, and a limited amount of knowledge that we can get through direct experience. So mediated experience, this being provided by books, by videos, but by any sort of input that comes from an experience that has been put together and shared on the internet, is very high. And all these elements create an environment that is even more complex than the one we face in our physical real life. This longing, this inability to have quick connections and understanding for what happens, is even more pervasive when you are not having a very good grasp of the world around you, and you are attempting to make connections, you are attempting to understand the society you are living in, you are discovering things yourself. And this is especially important for a teenager. They started to to get further and further from the family in an attempt to understand the world, to see what they are capable of. And in this environment, an abundance of information is a massive opportunity, but also a massive risk, because just about anywhere, if you know the right word, or if you happen to stumble upon a specific place, you can find all sorts of details that are good or bad depending on the circumstance. And we don't have this approach of being reasonable, being highly attentive at certain aspects if we have not developed this previously. If no one has helped us do this. And it's very important because I thought about this information abundance as being the main element that really creates a very difficult way of interacting with the internet. And the more we are creating the means of storing information in various formats from various experiences, we are increasing the amount of information that is going to be provided using these tools. And I think that we should be much more attentive when we think about these aspects. I am clearly against restricting access to information, but the problem is how you can have a good understanding that is going to help convey the meaning and showcase some things that happen in our society, even if we don't know or we don't have to know about them, but also have a way of seeing and understanding part of it so that we can have a very good judgment of risks. Moving further, I thought about peer mass influence. This is an important social phenomenon, even in our current real lives. However, the internet has put a different twist to it. And although the wording may not be academical in any way, I chose this way of considering my thoughts for a couple of reasons. First of all, although the main principle is still the same, the main reason behind the fact that we care for others and we try to do things as others have presumably judgmentally determined to be the best approach. But I also considered the fact that for a couple of reasons, we may be more inclined to be untrustworthy with others or to be unrealistic just because we want to experiment. And I thought about this picture as the best possible portrayal because in general we have a well-used, well-known path that gets quite far. And it's obvious where I'm pointing at in our lives. And we have other things that we may be curious about, but that may be sidelined to an extent. We might not know that this happens. We might not know that it happens due to us or due to others that have influenced our behavior, but this certainly happens. Sometimes the others influence due to reasons of experimentation or bullying, because I have to say that this is also an issue and it has never been entirely disconnected from this media, just as it was in our real lives. I think it brings a whole new meaning to that. And although we have a different opening towards experimenting with what others suggest. Sometimes, as I said, results are better for us if we follow that advice and go on the way each and everyone goes. Or sometimes it's better if we would just go and try to see what happens on ourselves or on a specific influence that we receive from the others. But the way of balancing these two approaches is very difficult. Sometimes you get to a different understanding and experience if you are doing just about what everyone suggests, and everyone suggests in a true manner. At other times, you may go on a bad decision, even if you are going with what the others are doing. And this back and forth game between going on the path that leads you further and stopping and seeing what happens in a specific circumstance is another situation when you have to be very tactful and you have to pay very much attention to what happens. Of course, we are making these mistakes as adults as well, but I think that children are even more at risk just because there are so many things that have not been attempted. There are so many things that seem so overly tempting. And all this environment creates quite a strong push towards experimentation that may lead to good and to bad results. Of course, just about any child has done that in real life. The only difference is that in this area you can experiment even more with yourself, with the others. And sometimes the lack of any responsibility and any care in this respect, and of course the perception of the others as being acknowledgeable voice, and acknowledgeable, the voice of acknowledgeable judgment to be more precise, I think that this is the biggest culprit. We have to stop and think, not only think about what the others are attempting to say, but think about how reasonable what they are saying is. If we don't understand, we shouldn't just go and search in a place where we have even more doubts. I think that in this case, the best way of approaching, but of course, this is a very difficult issue, is to get accustomed to search for a trustworthy source. But that trustworthy source has to be only pointing to a specific fact. Nothing more, nothing less. I don't think we have such a place. An encyclopedia may be a good one, a good point of starting this debate, but it just goes on to show that we need at least a reasonably accurate reflection of the world in order to at least assess if we should be experimenting with something or not. Of course, we don't have this straight-up approach as adults or as children, and all those tendencies take time in order to become a common behavior. But I think that we need to take very seriously this mass influence, because the numbers are huge. We can have tens, hundreds, thousands of persons that may react to something on the internet we say or what the others are saying, and make it seem like it's something that we have to take note of. And all this danger and all this opportunity has to be taken very seriously. I'm pretty sure we don't do that as much as we should, as much as we could, but anyway, it's important to know that this is clearly something that we have to address. I thought about control, because in general, just about any time when we are expressing ourselves, we are constrained by what the others have considered as a specific approach. On a specific website, we can only comment. On another one, we can create something and let the whole world know. So of course, the issue is much more complex than that. But ultimately, we have to do as we can in a specific environment that is being set up by the others. And others are also going to control how far we can wander in our experience. And all this constant exchange of information while we are assessing boundaries is even more important in the case of a younger person, because they are starting from a total lack of information, a total lack of any sort of detail that is key to understanding a specific environment. And I think that the whole way of presenting such things is lacking in many ways. The fact that we don't know the identity of the person that happens to be there, we cannot guess why their behavior is in a certain way, so we act just like we act with ourselves or other persons we know. And this is again another fallacy we may have, and a lot of cause for stress when we are interacting with ourselves or with persons that are even younger in age and that we should be protecting. And of course, all of these instances are even worse on the internet than in our real life. I'm not saying that real life is perfect, it's far from that. And to be deceiving is entirely possible also in real life. On the other side, on the internet, it's even more possible. So the issue of how we are judging control by the others and how safe of an environment we create so that we avoid some risks is a very important issue. And sometimes this is also used by others against us, or not necessarily, let's say, a rare occurrence. Persons, groups have a specific goal, and this goal may not be one that makes us list the best path, but one that is helpful to them because of commercial advantages, because of curiosity, because of their will to dominate the other. There could be so many potential reasons for which control is being used in a way that is against us but helpful to the one that is exerting control. Even if many times control is not necessarily as nefarious or bad as it seems. But this is important because the more we are in an environment that can be controlled by a specific instance, the more we are going to have the problem of too much or too little control and the consequences that come through them. And this is especially important because adults, grown-ups, are controlling the life of children, the environment in which they express themselves is entirely controlled by the adults. And this should be much more of a responsible thought and way of acting, but unfortunately I think it's far from that. Just to give you an example, when we are considering the fact that someone should be of a certain age to access a specific part of the internet, we are actually doing the worst in terms of control, because ultimately just about anyone understands that that place can still be accessed. There is a strong push towards seeing what happens or why this artificial barrier is being placed, and this happens, for instance, with adult entertainment, but not only that, gambling just as well. And in this case, I think that, of course, it's difficult to say who is actually in front of the screen, but some of the way in which they behave, at least I think they could be understood from a point further. And I don't think that everyone should be shunned out of accessing a specific image, and I clearly am against such a thing. It actually doesn't work that well. If you shun someone they find other ways of accessing it. And especially when the internet is so full of other examples, it's almost impossible to do that. Only if you certainly focus on identity, you can really stop someone. But this is also not entirely possible. But getting back, I think the issue is how much time a person spends on a specific place and how they are using it. That really triggers some decisions about their well-being. Unfortunately, this is used in a very wrong way, in my opinion, because most of the perspective of a successful company centers on how much and how long a person spends on that platform. And since profits is closely linked to the popularity of a certain thing, even if that is unhealthy, it's still an issue. So I think that the way in which control is being exerted by the others, whether for good or bad aspects, because I also mentioned bad, is a very major issue. And I thought about bad control because you can be very well deceived by someone that controls, for instance, a group on the internet. You can be quite well deceived in thinking that something is possible and that you should be following this for a specific reason, especially since we have a large gap between a game experience and our lives. And we feel that we need to fill that gap with something. And most of the time, unfortunately, especially for younger persons, these groups of people that may be showing an interest towards them may approach, especially when someone feels quite left outside. A lot of experience are, I think, the biggest dangers, the biggest risk that we are facing. And clearly, this has been proven time and time again, that you can make persons take such horrible acts as a crime or a suicide or hurting yourself to an extreme due to the fact that they were controlled by another group of persons or another person that clearly understood their their psychical imbalance. And I think that the issue of control is very important. Good control exerted by the others, so that one person doesn't persist in a behavior that is going to hurt. And also nefarious control that may be present from time to time in certain places, and we need to be aware of that. Moving further, I think that the most important thing that remains in this approach is the issue of self-control and awareness. It's very difficult to focus on your own instincts or your own perspective, especially at a younger age, because you have been proven time and time again that your inability to follow through certain activities initially due to your fear of pursuing it has been proven ineffective. And most of what you learn by taking on a certain risk. Unfortunately, this is highly detrimental when others are having an approach that centers on using your curiosity to follow their risky wills. And I think that awareness is very important, and this is why I mentioned the fact that you need to have a specific place of looking for when something goes wrong. And the issue of self-control is still important because, as mentioned, few persons are really interested in you having a great life, a great experience. Most are actually indifferent to what you are doing. And there are some that obviously want to harm you just because they feel the pleasure of hurting someone. So I think that all these issues create an environment that makes the internet an opportunity, but also a risk. And I thought about ways of tackling this. So let's move on. We are at the end of the current presentation, and I thought it appropriate to think about some ways in which you can certainly improve if you are a teenager or if you are a grown-up and you care for your children or any other person that you want to protect and to make the best out of the out of what the internet offers. And I thought about some simple suggestions. I think that the best way to have a strong understanding of what happens and what you should be doing is if you are a content creator, because this puts you on the forefront, or actually on the stage where you can see all the influence that others are making upon you. You see persons that encourage you, you see persons that are constantly trying to harass you. You may see persons that are indifferent and others that may have some suggestions. You see all those people interacting with you and you understand how these things happen depending upon your stance on a specific issue. While you may think that this also happens when you're on a social network, it's wholly different when you're talking to your captive audience or when you're talking to the whole world at large. And I think that this experience of getting to know persons and perspectives that are far outside your specific interests, your job, your family, anyone else you have met before, and having this sort of experience that lead to you communicating with the with everyone and receiving potential input from everyone is the best lesson you could have. And understanding it makes you highly suited to relating to a person that just starts their experience on the internet and has to navigate all these complex issues. So I thought about this as being essential. The next major suggestion is to constantly watch good content creators in order to be aware of trends and also to adjust your own behavior, understanding and stance on a specific subject, because we are in a highly dynamic society. Changes happen even quicker than they did before. So some of the things that we may be thinking are entirely ridiculous today may become an essential part of our lives later on. So we need to be very closely linked to them. I thought another important another important aspect is that the more platforms you are accustomed to have your presence on, the better, because each and every platform caters to a specific audience and has a specific way of conveying information, meaning, and various other ways of considering a subject. So if you have the ability of communicating with different persons on various groups, on various platforms, I hear you have the best way of understanding how complex the society is and what could happen if a specific issue occurs. Of course, it's quite difficult to enjoy the interaction perhaps with perspectives that are highly different from yours, for instance, ones that are not developed enough, and they may seem boring or annoying. And this may happen with some platforms that are designed for children and have only a specific approach that is overly pointless when you see it at large, or it's is entirely annoying, as I said before. But you have to get accustomed to them. You have to notice what the others are using, and follow the flow on these issues by learning to use them properly. So I think this is another important aspect that I wanted to show. Moving further, I think that it's essential to showcase good internet culture examples. You need persons, you need pages, you need style. Ultimately, you got to have a specific collection of pages, persons, areas on the internet, websites. That specifically focus on one particular subject, or that offer a broad understanding of the others. And I think that they will be highly beneficial for the following reason. You need to have a trustworthy source. I'm entirely sure that an encyclopedia has its own drawbacks due to the fact that some of the information you may search may not be readily available or may be readily found on such a place, but I think it's a good starting point. You need a reference. You need somewhere to look upon when you have a doubt, when you heard the first time about something, and you don't want to take entirely for granted what you heard on a group, on a website, on people commenting on a specific content, whether it's a video, a photo, or anything else. And I think this is the place to start. Think about Wikipedia. It's not the best resource in many ways, but it's the best out of what we can find. And it's very good to make a habit of making the others look in this place the first when they have a doubt, and then, let's say, refine their search based upon what they see and understand there. Because if they have this first contact with a trustworthy source, then they can look and find that if things are entirely approached as they should or not, but they will not have the perspective that is damaging to them. They will not have the best experience, but certainly it's not damaging. I think this is very important. Of course, there are other persons. There are very good content creators on the internet. Various YouTube channel content creators, or I don't know, persons that make posts on Facebook, on Instagram, on Twitter, on just about any place, convey useful meaning. You have to track and know all these places, including, I don't know, billboards, just about anything that could be of use at a certain time when doubts are high pertaining to a specific issue, and especially when you are required to act on something. And I think this one is entirely important. Then, I thought about developing taste early in children. I think that we have to make them see as early on as possible good examples. They may not understand them, or they may completely not understand them at that age. I'm thinking about persons that could be just 1 or 2 years old, but they have the ability to memorize something. They will see pictures, they will see things, and they will be happy or sad about them. And a specific fact is going to be memorized. And all these things put together create an expectation later. And I'm entirely sure that whether these things are entirely successful or not, they create the foundation for something that can develop later on. And I don't think we understand enough not only the perspective of, I don't know, playing back videos that seem to calm a child. No, I think it should be much more. Yeah, there should be things that are going to have a very good impact. Show, I don't know, beauties of nature. Show very well behaving persons that are smiling, that are not violent, that are that seem to be enjoying something. Because all those things, even if they are entirely understood at that age, are going to have a lasting influence on what happens later. Just as your child may remember interactions it had with you, they may also remember glimpses of that experience you showed. And I thought that creating a very good playlist that runs from time to time without disturbing. The fact is that, of course, it's something in the background and it's not always present. I think that is going to create a good expectation for what a child may choose to enjoy, because ultimately what they are being shown is what they get fond of. Only later, if they develop, and they certainly develop their taste, they can look for something else. But they have to be accustomed to something that is good, beneficial, whatever you want to consider, or at least that satisfies a curiosity without risking an approach that could make dangerous behavior acceptable. And I think that one of the most unpleasant facts is that we sometimes focus too little on this, and previously, but even now, the risk of having or looking at something, for instance, on YouTube, on TikTok, on whatever platform you have, there is the risk of running into other videos that are very far from the point you start at. So if you don't have a very good selection, you should at least disable the feature that goes on to any sort of depth and just run in a loop what you already have, but think about large amounts of time. So this is why I mentioned this automatic exposure, scripted auto rounds of videos. I think they are the best. I think they are the easiest. If you have a good selection, use it. And then, as needed, make some changes. This will not, however, and you should be highly aware, this will not be a way for you to avoid interacting. No, this is going to be something in the background that makes a person be reasonably comfortable with being independent, but also leaves a lot that has to be explained and guided by a parent. And I think that this is what a grown-up adult. And I think those elements are very important. Of course, grown-up adult, I'm not saying that adults are the only ones that could make this interaction. Even higher, a slightly older a relative could be very good. But it's important to have an environment and to know and to constantly showcase it so that it can have an influence and control how it's being done. I think this is the most important issue. Then, of course, as the person, as your child or that younger individual is going to develop, they will need to be guided in their interaction. You have to think about places that should already be set as their home base, the things that they could start to look upon when they want to have something. And I thought about specific channel subscriptions, specific persons that might be followed on a social network, just about anything you could do in an application or in a place that they will communicate with the other, mostly on the telephone, on the computer they have, and to have this start in what you're showcasing. And in this way, you will have high quality material that is going to be provided, and it will create an expectation, even if it's not their own preference, for a specific way of presenting various aspects. Of course, just about any person can understand and can change at one point in their lives and want to see, I don't know, outrageous behavior or anything else, but they have something to fall back upon, and this behavior that they fall back upon is one that is non-threatening, is calm, is comfortable. So this is the important aspect, how you're setting the stage. And I thought about this as being very important, especially when there are such dangerous occurrences, in my opinion, with those very short videos that are, for instance, are being played on TikTok or other networks that focus on the same addictive short-term video that can be placed in a loop with no distraction, because they seamlessly create an environment that can lead to just about anything, and it plays upon our curiosity and our visual interests. And it's very bad, because I think we should be at least disconnected from such a reality, or offered an alternative. Because ultimately, you cannot shield someone entirely from a specific environment, but you should be considering how you're going to complement this way of avoiding a specific place by providing something else with similar value. So you have to be very knowledgeable, and you have to stay ahead. So it's very difficult being a parent. It's very demanding. It's very demanding to be a person that minds someone else's activity in a judgmental and responsible way. But I think it is essential, and you should understand as a parent, or even more as a person that, I don't know, is a grandfather or a grandmother or another relative, that it's essential to have a good grasp on what the internet offers. Do not leave an experience go unnoticed, or if it's unnoticed, uncontrolled. And if this happens, then it's better not to get involved in any way. Just leave the others that are better in this task to handle it, or at least limit what damage could be done. And I think this is the biggest issue, because when we are leaving another person to have the responsibility of interacting with our children, we should already know these things, understand, seek them, check if they are really carried out as such. And I think this is very difficult, and very few parents are entirely aware of the importance of these elements. They may consider that, oh, okay, since they, especially when they grow up, the fact that they survive certain potential threats, it means that they understood. No, it's far from that. They understood at most only in a superficial way, and they may be constrained not to act upon what they saw. But this is not enough. They should have their own self-defense, their own self-control mechanism that is being triggered by a good experience that was being provided by the others, not as an experience that was left, let's say, in an unfinished state, and they were left to pick up the pieces. If they want to do that very well, they should have the opportunity. But the first point is that there should be an advised voice that at least start a discussion. Whether that discussion is going to be continued, enjoyed or not, you should at least be aware of constant threats. Moving on, I thought about those challenges, and I consider them separately from suggestions, because there are issues that we do not have any control over them, yet they are very important to understanding the true complexity of our responsibility. First of all, I thought about changes that happen even quicker in our environment. We have to think about games that have a massive influence that could be almost unheard of, impossible in a specific environment that was only, I don't know, a couple of years before. Yet they become a custom. They become ways of thinking and seeing the world with perhaps no inhibition. And we have to accept that, that things change so quickly, and we may be faced with the prospect of having to look for an alternative, or at least finding a way of guiding the interaction of our children in that environment. And I think this is even more important today. We are just starting to have discussions about entering the metaverse. Yes, as is being portrayed by Facebook or others. But this goes on to show that it's even more difficult to understand what happens today and to have the proper response to it. But this will happen even more in the future, because we will be forced even from a younger age to interact in a specific environment in order to have a fulfilling experience that helps us develop. So, as mentioned, I think it's mandatory to have a good grasp of what happens around, and to have good suggestions that are prepared just around a specific environment or subject is being placed upon in a discussion. And I think that this is much more important than you may consider. And of course, you have to look further than your present interests to have a good list of all those places. Another problem is that you have to accept the fact that you need other persons that are good examples, and those good examples have to get into an interaction with your child on different issue. You have to find those persons, you have to ask them kindly to have a good communication with your child, and this is much more important than you may consider, because those persons have to be skilled. They have to be trustworthy and skilled in most of what happens on the internet. It's not easy to find those persons, especially if you're not someone who has a very good grasp or had the chance to meet those persons. But in this area, again, it's a major advantage if you are a content creator, because you get to know other persons that may, for instance, comment on your videos, may support you, that are your public, that might be interested to interact not only with you, but with a close relative of yours, in this case your child. And if they are trustworthy enough, then it's a wonderful opportunity also for them and for you. In general, those things are not, or have not been traditionally being carried out outside the family, but trusting individuals from work environments, and especially when we are considering the fact that the work environment has changed so much and it has been expanded to encompass just about anyone we could be strongly interacting with around the world. I think that it brings a whole new meaning to how we can address this way of guiding our children, our child's experience in the world. And we have to think about such persons that could be willful, could have the will to assist us. And it's not impossible and it's not far-fetched. You may not find that many persons, you may find a couple of them, you may find no one from the internet, and you have to rely on our family or on friends. But it's important to always think about and search those persons, because they are going to be essential, even if the task is very difficult, and especially when you have to think that they have to be persons that are having a good grasp of many sides. They have to have different perspectives on the society, so that at one point they are not going to be entirely the only way of seeing a specific subject. To offer this diversity that helps a younger person have a good grasp of what happens and not be that limited. And of course, because our children are going to be even more involved in an online world, you have to think about more persons than in the past. And this is why I consider a family to be not entirely adequate just in and on itself. There have to be many other persons that want and that are responsible in this behavior, because you also have a child that, as mentioned before, is going to interact with thousands of persons. So interacting just with two or three persons that they may mostly do in on a specific family is not going to cut it. And I think this is going to be even more important in the future. Then there are some other challenges I thought about. The idea of having some sorts of prepared subjects, prepared elements that you want to showcase in a good way. Depending on a specific subject that you may cover. And this will be very helpful when you want to have a good case, but not necessarily present your own, because to a younger person, you may seem biased in a specific approach. You have to present at least a couple of perspectives, and those not be entirely the same as yours. And the more difference you can show without detracting from the right message that could be understood out of diversity. One of the particular examples you have shown is actually what you should be doing. The others are good to know, but in a way that doesn't have any sort of risk when they are going to see them. I think this is a very good approach. And it's going to be even more important because when, as I said, you're having someone else of a young age that interacts so much with the others, you have to be prepared very quickly to have some answers. And being able to search for them and have a good way of showcasing is going to be essential, because you have to answer quickly to things that happen in your child's life. And one of the last things I considered is the fact that you need to have alternate accounts. You need to have different ways of expressing yourself on a specific platform. Just because you want to make someone understand that it's not impossible to have a different perspective on something and leave it in a consistent way. And if they understand that, they may also understand the fact that others may have an interest for which they showcase only a particular part of their lives. This is going to be highly important, and also you need to check how your child reacts in certain environments, because you're going to pick even more out of what they may not readily tell to you in person, or they may not readily tell you when they know whom they are interacting with. And having this particular ambiguity is going to be very good on the long run. Of course, I'm not someone to strongly push for having a false identity. No, it's far from that. But sometimes you may need to have a way of not being obvious without being nefarious to your own child, in order to, or your own close relative, that you're not going to be left outside what happens, and have so many risks that are not going to be assessed at the right time. So I hope you enjoyed the video. Thank you very much for watching. I hope the subject was not overly boring, and suggestions and the way in which the information was presented is reasonable, because I know I may not be using the best ways of conveying specific information, but I hope that what matters the most is the message and how well some connections are being made. So the presentation may not be that spectacular, but I hope that it was not annoying. So see you next time.